Hello everyone, back. It is the next day. I have finished the bulk of the cage work. The exit port of the DustDeputy sits in there. And you'll notice the line that I've drawn and doodled. That's to get it to fit just a little bit better. Especially once I put the rubber couplers on, I'm going to need a little more. Now, the other thing you may notice is it's a little bit asymmetric here. Now, it'll be better after I trim this, but it's still going to be, there's going to be a little bit more space here than here. Why is that? Why is this not symmetric? And most of that stems from the fact that I may have done this a little bit backwards because I didn't have a plan. I only had rough sketches. I didn't have a cut list. I didn't have an assembly sequence. And as you saw, I had drilled and then cut the larger hole for these mounting plates. This is the one that actually goes underneath the lid on the bucket. But I'd done all that so that I could secure the DustDeputy and get it all in place and then do the mock-up like you saw and then kind of build this around it. Inaccuracies creep in. And the biggest one is this. I cut these a little small to make sure they would fit, skewed everything. Place after getting a little bit annoyed that things were asymmetrical. The buckets, these are blown thermoplastic. They're not 100% symmetric. The DustDeputy itself, while it's well made and pretty durable, is again a blown thermoplastic into molds. Not 100% symmetric. As you add all that up and then the amount of slop, there's probably 3/8 of an inch of slop in there that I introduced by allowing this to be off-center in all directions. You get this. So be aware of that if you're doing this. Now that I have decided on the path for the cage, had I to do it over again, I would have measured and made everything symmetric, and this would have been cut symmetrically, and so on. And I'm going to try to smooth some of these edges. Surprisingly, of all the equipment I have, I don't have a belt sander anymore. I had an old one, and the motor was going on it, and it finally burned up. So I'm going to have to do some tricks on the disc sander and then hand sanding. I may try to cut some chamfers on this on the bandsaw if I can get it angled in there correctly and just kind of freehand that. But I want to soften these edges a bit, especially here. I'm going to have to go get some hardware, some bolts, and I think some extra fender washers. I don't believe I have enough. Act as sliders or friction bearings in between all the joints. But yeah, this is now in the home stretch. And I'll shoot a little bit of footage and then I'll show you the full thing once it's together here. Because dear God, I've got to vacuum this place. It is horrifically dusty, dirty, nasty. Okay, I'm doing most of the cuts with the jigsaw. I've now widened that out a bit. You can see it's kind of uneven. This is the reason why it would have been nice if I could have got this right the first time before it was all assembled. But again, prototype. It'll be functional. I'm using the jigsaw in scrolling mode so I can pivot the head around. Well, I'll try to clean that up with a drum sander. It also makes a hell of a lot of dust. I really, really hate MDF. Have I said that already? So the input nozzle sticks out and then the holes line up. And I've got some room on either side so I can then bottom out that... how I wish I'd done this before I assembled the thing. This is what happens when you get in a hurry, even with prototyping. So I tried the bandsaw. I can't get it to fit on there. I still want to try to put a chamfer
on these edges a little bit. So here's what I've come up with. I'm going to use my miter gauge. I've got the saw blade set at about a 45 degree angle. I'm going to clamp the piece to the miter gauge, and then I'm going to start the saw, raise the blade once it's coming up through and it's at the depth I want, then I can go ahead and finish the cut. But I can't raise it unless this piece is past where the cut is going to be. So this is going to be a little bit fiddly. I'm kind of nervous about doing this, but it's something, it's a useful skill, so I want to give it a try. Well, that worked. And I got close to the bevel I want. I don't know if I'm going to try to get any closer or not. I don't think that's a good idea, honestly. Excuse me. I am covered in some dust here. I got most of it off, though. I just pulled a Bill Murray and Stripes and used the vacuum blower head attachment on my shop vac. One of the reasons I love that shop vac is that detaches and you connect the jet hose piece and it becomes a leaf blower. Well, I just cleaned my garage with that. I sanded, used the disc sander and generated a boatload of MDF dust. I didn't want to plug up that brand new filter. I went ahead and sanded. I was able, I couldn't get this to work. I got the one cut on the table saw. What I ended up doing then was finagling around and maneuvering, and I rounded these over, rounded the corners just roughly on the using the disc sander, and that only took a few minutes, but boy, that generated a lot of nasty dust. This is home stretch time. I've almost got this ready. The only remaining piece I haven't worked out 100% is where to drill the holes in the back to mount onto the plastic trundle cart. And the other thing I need is a spacer block, because if you put a straight edge across the two surfaces where the board will rest against, you can see there's a gap here, and it's almost exactly a half an inch. So I've got some half inch scraps that OSB over there. There's a little square of it. I will cut a rectangular piece for that, for here, and another one for here to act as a spacer. And that way, when I bolt through, even with the big fender washers sitting on the inside of these, they're utility wells, I won't risk pulling or stretching or tearing through the plastic. It'll all be solid bracing. As it happened, these fender washers that I have are perfect size. They fit right in there. So get one of these each in the thread wells, drill the holes, match the holes to the block of wood, put the block of wood on, and then also drill through to the backside of that. Okay, get some of the dust off of me here so I can run down to the store, and I've got my list of bolts that I gotta buy. For the scissor arms or lift arms. I've got all four lift arms cut here to size. I just got done sanding and easing the edges using my disc sander. What a mess! Oh my god. I've cut from OSB, the inserts for the spacers. These aren't quite exactly what I need. I need a little bit more thickness. So a single fender washer thickness is sufficient. And I'm going to need one more standard size washer for the nut that's going to be on the underside of that per well. And so there's four wells. So so I just drilled some holes down inside of the wells here. The way I kept things centered was I plopped the fender washer down in the well to drill the pilot hole, and then using that as my eyeball center, I drilled the, then I came using that pilot hole then centered with the larger drill through. So now the next step is to mark where to drill through on the wooden plugs. So the way I'm going to do that is take a Sharpie, place this over top, and then mark the center holes. Using those, take a punch, punch the center, and then again, drill a small pilot hole, and then drill a quarter inch hole. Should be able to fit these bolts down through. Tap those in and no problem. Looks good. About just line this all up, braced this up on some blocks, and then ran a center punch down through the holes, gave it a whack. Then I did a two-stage drill with a pilot hole and then the final quarter inch. All of the bolts line up and drop right through. They are a little bit long, but I'm actually going to be mounting them the other way where this head will be on the bottom, and then they can just stick up through here because there's nothing going to be in there. It's just a question of finishing the setup and alignment of the lift arms. Yeah, home stretch. I'm going to take my time, make sure I get these nice and lined up on the same axis straight through, and nice and parallel, same distance on everywhere. And then I can finally start using the equipment in here without making such a horrible mess. Just sanding some of this stuff. You can see the debris that it leaves. And I, like I said, I had blown this out earlier with the shop vac blower, and just cutting the little pieces I have, you can see how much sawdust it's throwing there underneath the rigid table saw. This stuff does go everywhere. Such a mess. But yeah, I'm pretty happy this project's coming to a close. It's something I've needed for a while. Okay, next segment. You have to pardon the noise outside. One of the neighbors apparently has a carpet vacuuming place in. These spacer pieces that go between the trundle base and the cart for the shop vac itself, I went ahead and glued them down. I put the bolts through from the bottom side to create my alignment point. Used, again, I'm just sticking with the construction adhesive. I'm using up the rest of that tube. And the scrap pieces of OSB I had, cut them to shape, and you saw that earlier, I think. I'm filming these segments out of order, so bear with me. Those are now dried overnight. Here is the full mock-up of what I've got. And you can see that's roughly where the parallel arms are going to go. I wanted to sleep on this before I did anything else. Essentially, what I'm going to do is I've checked everything for parallel and true as much as I can. And I'm going to measure the same distance down and the same distance in. And that's going to be an axle hole. And ditto for this one. And then I'm just going to duplicate those measurements on the other vertical upright. Mirrored, of course. The other thing I'm going to do then is stack the four swivel arm pieces that I have. Stack them together. I'm going to stack and clamp these together and then drill each set of axle holes in one shot. So everything's accurate. I don't have any measurement issues where I'm off here and there, because that can create a binding problem for the lift. Presuming I do that carefully, then all four arms are parallel to one another and all of the axles are in the same plane, and all the holes should be collinear straight through. Using some geometry terms there, my old geometry teacher, Miss Holquist, would be proud. The only other thing I have to do is a little bit of shaping. I want to put this on the bandsaw and kind of round this over, kind of clean the edge up, because I can see this bumping into stuff and catching and everything else. I've got to be careful of is the, I don't want to cut in too far and compromise some of the structural integrity, and the hole for the caster is in here somewhere. I don't have to spot that.
At that point, it's just a question of sanding and painting. It's a nice day outside. It finally warmed up here. You can see how bright it is. Probably not going to film much of that. It's going to be pretty boring. And just going to be using the palm sander with 80 and 100 grit paper. I'm not worried about a super duper finish on this. I just want to get all the rough edges and bits of glue and sharp corners and stuff rounded and get everything sanded down. Then I'll blast it off with the air compressor and I'll be ready for paint. I want to try to get all this done today. So this is stretched on for a week. It's a week longer than I thought it would take, but when you're inventing something on the fly, that happens. Right, just a quick display of what I've come up with for clamping to make sure these all stay lined up as I do my drilling. Applied the two smaller clamps to hold them tightly together, and then carefully added the larger clamp with the two blocks of wood to act like a clamping rail or clamping call. Now it's just a question of drilling them. Okay, there's one detail I wanted to point out here. Pardon the noise, I've got a fan running because it's two days ago it was 33. Today it is 71. I don't like Houston. I'll just leave it at that. Okay, I've got the first two arms in, the lower ones, and I've got the upper ones pinned to the verticals. And now I'm getting ready to mark the positions. And it dawned on me, in case someone wondered how I was doing this, I probably got a document. Given the slight variations in everything, the most independent way I could come up with is knowing that these pieces were all cut the same width. The best option was to set up a common edge. So when I clamped and drilled them, I put a mark, I don't know if you'll be able to see it, on the underside of all of the pieces. Okay. And just said arbitrarily, that's going to be my underside, that'll be my marker orientation. So that kind of helped keep things uniform. The other thing I did was, after figuring out roughly, just eyeballing where I wanted these to be, I said, okay, I want to pin them in there and make sure the arms themselves are level. Even if the holes are a little bit off, they're off the same on all of them because I drilled them all at the same time. So I measured down from the top, knowing that these verticals were cut to the exact same length, right? I knew I'd have the same measurement on each side. As close as you can get with wood. And so I measured down the back, struck a line across, and then put a combo square on the back face. And using that, and that's actually what I used to support the arms, okay, to determine where to punch that hole into cage uprights. I hope that makes sense. I'm repeating the same thing here for the upper two, and the net result is I know that the bottom then of that support arm is parallel to the one on the bottom. Okay, these two bottom edges are parallel. And by keeping the arms parallel, I'm essentially ensuring that I keep the entire mechanism parallel. So I shouldn't get any. I'm hoping this makes sense, but this was how I decided to use a common reference line, common base reference, to try to keep everything trued up and lined up. Okay, first test. I've just finger tightened all of the nuts on the bolts. Presumption is there'll be a little handle here. Possibly here, that I lift up on. So let's see how it works. Aha! Okay. It only needs to come up about that far anyway, because it really only needs to come up about an inch to get the bucket in and out to empty it. But it looks repeatable. Ha ha ha! Okay. My crazy idea isn't crazy. It's actually working. Right, there's one little tip I wanted to document. Since I'm going to be sanding and painting all of this, I'm going to lose all my cute little alignment marks so I know which way things go. So for example, I know that I had put a drawn alignment mark on these when I originally cut the holes through. So I lined those marks back up to make sure I've got, you know, everything squared away, the whole pattern's what I had. Then I just took a handsaw and I filed a little chunk there and a matching chunk on that one,
So I know when I put this all together for final assembly, those are going to line up. So I can make sure that any irregularities in how I drilled stuff will match. I wanted to mark one edge on the bottom. So I lined them up, put on a clamp. I'm going to take the saw. I'm going to file cut just a little channel here. And then that'll be my alignment marks for reassembly. All the pieces painted. They are still drying. They've each got about three coats of a couple different types of enamel. I ended with a dusting of this automotive enamel. This is about two-thirds of a can. But I used about a can and a half of primer that I had left to put a pretty heavy primer coat on the lever arm pieces, on the trundle cart itself, and upon the lift cage for the Cyclone. And then that was curing in the afternoon sun, so then I hit it with multiple coats of some different blacks I had. There was a partial can of something, and then I had one Rust-Oleum can that was actually a matte finish, and then I had this two-thirds of a can that was automotive enamel that I dusted everything down with, and everything looks better in black. Johnny Cash was right. I've had the fan running here in the garage most of the evening while we were out and about trying to help air it out. It's a little bit fumey. And I think they're coming out pretty good. So tomorrow, before I assemble it, I've got about two-thirds of a can of some polyurethane that was left from another project. So I will dust all of the pieces, and I focused the paint on some of the high wear areas because I'm sure I'm going to be grabbing and dragging, and the hoses are going to be scraping across it and everything. So these have, I don't know, four or five coats of the enamels on them. I also heavily dusted the edges because that's going to get knocked into, and a pretty good coating here where the bucket is going to be slamming in and out. But I'm pretty excited. It's funny how the paint hides a multitude of little flaws that bugged me. The edges rounded over pretty nice. I think I did an okay job with that, kind of rounding things out. I have bolted the lift arms on, and the way they work is there's a fender washer pretty much everywhere, and then in the middle junction in between, there's a fender washer and then a smaller regular washer. Because the fender washers tend to bite in and stick to the painted wood. So essentially the three washer stack here, the middle washer becomes my bearing surface. I've got the wheels on. They are Loctited in now. And got some gasket silicone underneath this piece and on top of the under lid piece. So that's all sealed. There wasn't really enough room to goop any silicone in between the wooden disc and the Cyclone, but based on my test, I don't think it's going to be necessary. If it looks like I'm leaking any air at some point, I can always run a bead around the outside. I called it a little bit close in terms of placement. There's like just a fraction of a gap. I don't even know if it's going to show up on camera there. Maybe a 64th of an inch. But I went ahead and after looking at some more data online, I went ahead and put the hose clamps back on the rubber plumbing couplers and snug those up, not too tight. Now this will be a little more stable and robust with the shop back on.
It's a little bit tight. But it does maneuver pretty well around corners. So,
trundle it over here.
Yeah, it's really crowded in here. I gotta clean some of this out, but I think that's going to be an amazingly helpful addition to the shop.
And it looks like I got the wheels just about dead on for being 85% scrap pieces. Aside from the bolts, the Dust Deputy, and the rubber coupler, that is all scrounged, including casters. So, pretty happy. I hope that encourages someone. I hope it inspires you to build stuff of your own out of scrounged and recycled bits. God, that's gonna be so nice. I showed you earlier, down in here, it's two fender washers with a smaller washer that fits these quarter 20 bolts. And that acts as my bearing plate. And there's one on each joint surface. And the other thing I did was here, I've got the regular nuts that are a little bit tight. And then I put the Nylock locking nuts on and then double nutted it, essentially made a jam nut out of it as well. So that should never work its way loose. It draws one hell of a vacuum. You can actually see the top of the shop vac kind of dimple in a little when it kicks on. It's pretty impressive. But yeah, it's done, finally. Thank God. So, thank you, Lord, for getting me through it. But yeah, I am done. It is time to put this to use and get going on projects. That's where things are. I count that as a success, and I'm really, really, really happy with it. So if you have questions, feel free to leave them in the comments. I'll try to answer them when I can. I hope it encourages you to make your own cart. So, on to more wood dust. Thanks for watching. I'll have to work on that. But if you're doing one, you may want to rethink that. Oh well.